Washington, D.C., home to our nation's capital and more than 639,000 residents, plus more than 22 million tourists visit annually. With that many people in one area, the demand for reliable, safe drinking water is a priority. A mission that falls on the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, which has overseen the operations of the Washington Aqueduct since the 1860s. The aqueduct mission was born out of a fire and the realization that the city needed a robust water supply.
They needed a way to get water that didn't have the waterborne diseases, but also they needed fire protection. And there was a fire in the Capitol building in 1851. I think it was Christmas Eve of 1851. And there was not enough water to put out the fire because the way the fire department worked, you had a horse-drawn carriage with a drum in the back, maybe 150, 200 gallons, and the horse would get to the fire, they'd pump it out. So they didn't have any means to put out the fire.
The nation's leaders turned to one entity, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, to tackle this problem. The job of designing and initially overseeing the construction of the new water supply system fell on the shoulders of one Captain Montgomery C. Meigs, who you may know is famous for founding Arlington National Cemetery, when he ordered the burial of Union soldiers in the Rose Garden of General Robert E. Lee's estate, right next to Lee's mansion in Arlington, Virginia.
This is 1853. There's no electricity, so the only motive power you have is gravity. So Montgomery Meigs, as a Corps of Engineer officer, had worked in Washington, D.C. one other time, was called back to Washington to lay out this system.
Given the time the aqueduct was built, electricity and electrical pumps were decades away from becoming a reality. Meigs would have to rely on steam pumps or a much cheaper and natural option, gravity.
Now, the Washington Aqueduct that we know now is really the culmination of three phases. The first phase, from 1853 until 1900, was gravity-fed water supply from the Potomac River, built with an intake on the Potomac and a conduit, 9-foot diameter conduit, that runs from Great Falls to the Dale Carlier Reservoir and then down to what we call the Georgetown Reservoir. And that was Meigs' achievement.
One major hurdle that had to be jumped in sending Potomac River water to the District of Columbia via the aqueduct came in the form of a large ravine at Cabin John Creek.
To do that was a huge undertaking, because the water had to be put in this conduit, but also the conduit had to pass over a large ravine. And in the process of doing that, Meigs and his team and the Corps built what is now known as the Cabin John Bridge. Originally, it was called the Union Arch Bridge. When completed, it was the longest single-span masonry arch bridge in the world. And it was not to carry people, although it did provide a means of transit from downstream up to the up intakes, but it was a 9-foot diameter conduit built into the top of this bridge.
To this day, the bridge continues to support the conduit carrying water, as well as vehicles over the Cabin John Creek and Cabin John Parkway.
There is nothing about the Meigs work that needs to be replaced, because what Meigs has done, because he couldn't do it any other way, was provide a gravity-fed system from the river, which saves an enormous amount of money in not having to pump water out of the river. So the production costs are lower, and they're more reliable.
Parts of the original late 1860s built aqueduct continues to service Washington, D.C. to this day. Meigs was extremely proud of the project, even going so far as to have the 39-step iron circular staircase leading to the pipe vault in the Georgetown Reservoir cast with M.C. Meigs on each riser. Through a series of improvements, the Washington Aqueduct's mission, that was originally for firefighting and drinking water for the district, expanded to include servicing Arlington County and parts of Fairfax County in Virginia.
The metropolitan area, as it grew, so Arlington hooked into the system in 1927 and became a customer, and then the city of Falls Church, an independent city which had a very large distribution system in what is Fairfax County in Northern Virginia, they became a customer in 1947.
It also meant that as demand for safe drinking water increased and new standards to remove pathogens were being developed, the system needed to evolve. The McMillan Reservoir was completed in 1902 and was connected to the Washington Aqueduct via the Washington City Tunnel, which funnels water from the 42-acre Georgetown Reservoir to the 38-acre McMillan Reservoir. A few years later, simply allowing sediment to fall out of the water column was no longer deemed an acceptable process for removing pathogens. A revolutionary treatment plant was completed in 1905. The McMillan Sand Filtration Plant, located on the grounds of the McMillan Reservoir, used vaults filled with sand to filter the water. The water was pumped over the top of the sand and it would slowly soak through the sand. which would filter out the pathogens, and is credited with helping to rid the city of typhoid epidemics. The filtration plant was so successful it remained in use all the way up until 1986 and could filter up to 75 million gallons per day. One drawback, the sand would have to be regularly raked to maintain a level surface for the water to flow over and through, which is why it was replaced in 1986 with a more modern water treatment plant requiring less maintenance. Shortly after its original completion in 1902, a unique feature was added to the McMillan Reservoir, a fountain created by artist Herbert Adams. The fountain consisted of three graces on top of a pink granite base and was a tribute to James McMillan, U.S. Senator from Michigan, for whom the reservoir was named. The senator sat on the Committee on the District of Columbia and worked to enhance many aspects of the nation's capital, including expansion of the aqueduct. The fountain's statue, minus its larger base, remains on the McMillan Reservoir grounds to this day. As drinking water standards became more stringent, the aqueduct operations adapted. In the 1920s, the Washington Aqueduct received a major upgrade. A second pipeline was added, and with water demand on the rise and water treatment procedures evolving, the Dale Carlia Water Treatment Plant was built. Consisting of a rapid sand filter, the plant could filter the water quicker than the sand filters used at McMillan. Today's operations look very different from the ones that Meigs built, but one of the main components, the original gravity-fed conduit from the Potomac River to the sedimentation basin at Dale Carlia Reservoir, remains to this day. Washington, D.C.'s water journey begins at Jennings Randolph Lake in the upper reaches of the Potomac River along the Maryland and West Virginia border. From there, it flows through the Jennings Randolph Dam and travels down the Potomac to the inlets near Great Falls, Maryland, and further down to Little Falls near Bethesda, Maryland, where a pumping station was added in 1959.
The water that comes by gravity goes into the forebay. At the forebay, it naturally settles any heavy stuff. As the water slows down, it would naturally settle. Then it would go through a screen to before it finds its way to the Dale Carlia plant.
Once the water is screened, it continues to flow by gravity to the Dale Carlia plant where the treatment process begins.
At the Dale Carlia plant, we add alum, which would help settle, and fluoride, and it goes to the basin where anything that could settle would settle out at the bottom of the sedimentation basin, and then the water flows by gravity into a gravity dual media gravity filter.
The filters are rapid sand filters, which consist of small pieces of anthracite coal, sand, and gravel contained in concrete walled boxes. The water flows down through the layers where it is collected via perforated pipes, and then it moves on to the disinfection portion of its treatment process.
And from then on, meeting all EPA drinking water regulation requirements, it would find its way into the clear walls, and at that point we add more hypo or chlorine for disinfection, and it would have to stay a certain time in contact with chlorine, and we can calculate how many and meet the regulation. From then on, we can add ammonia to change the water to the chloramine. From then it goes to the pumping station where it gets pumped into the distribution system.
Even with all the modern technology, the system still needs a dedicated team of professionals to monitor it.
This facility is operated 24/7, 365, so that means we're always here because the fact that the people is not going to stop turning on the tap, right? So you got to make sure the water is available whenever the citizen needs it and wants to have it.
Water plant operators at both the Dale Carlia and McMillan treatment plants consistently test the water at each stage of the process to make sure the water is meeting EPA safe drinking standards and to make sure the proper amount of treatment chemicals are being added. Additionally, the operators clean the filters in a process called backwashing, where treated water and compressed air is blown up through the layers of the rapid sand filter to remove any particles that may have made it to the filtration cells. Each day, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers produces around 135 million gallons of drinking water, which is then distributed to water authorities in the region.
We treat water and we deliver clean drinking water to these three entities. The D.C. government, or D.C. Water, and Fairfax Water, and Arlington County. And they take those water that we deliver to them and put it through their distribution system, and which deliver to their individual household, their constituents, and their customers.
Even after water is distributed to the three water authorities, chemists and microbiologists at the Dale Carlia treatment plant test the water samples provided by the three entities to make sure what is flowing out of their taps is free of pathogens and well within clean drinking water standards.
Although we are unique in the Army, in the Corps, we are not unique as far as the Safe Drinking Water Act is concerned. We start to meet those mandates and all the EPA requirements in terms of the the water quality standards. We have to meet them. And so, so in other words, that's the water that we produce that meets EPA Safe Drinking Water Act requirements.
While the region has grown over the past few decades, the demand for additional drinking water hasn't. That is due in large part to an upgrade in how we handle waste.
The demand is reduced because water-saving features. Toilets that use less water to flush, dishwashers, washing machines, low-flow shower heads. So there are some physical things that have been put into our plumbing systems that cause less water to be used to create the same outcome.
For the 145 U.S. Army Corps of Engineers employees charged with overseeing the aqueduct, their mission is clear, and they remain steadfast in meeting that mission.
The Corps of Engineers, a federal entity, but it's apolitical. It's not following some, that there's no political drive for them to create a course of action or a policy. They're there to deliver the product. Nationally, that's true too, but within Washington Aqueduct. So it's very easy to work with Washington Aqueduct because you've got D.C. and Virginia as customers, and they know that the aqueduct, the Corps of Engineers, is going to represent the best interests of them and the best interests of the water.
So, the next time you visit the nation's capital and turn on a water faucet, shower head, or even flush the toilet, know a team from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is working around the clock to make sure that water is safe and reliable.
The water we produce, provide to District of Columbia, we all know that's the seat of the government. And so we're very proud of our mission, right? This is, we take our job very seriously. We know that we got to provide that safe drinking water for the citizens living in District of Columbia, but at the same time, the security of the water, because that is the seat of the government. And so, yeah, that's something we are very proud of.